Hi, everybody. Welcome. And thank you so much for joining us here at our Putting Privacy into Perspective webinar. We're going to have a great hour. I've got a group of wonderful panelists to get our arms around this topic a little bit that's been floating around our heads in the industry for, well, the past few years, let's face it, since going back to GDPR and even a little bit before that. So I'm very excited to have a conversation around this to help frame, work out what we need to do, get perspective and look at what our options are for a path forward and how we should be thinking about this as marketers. So my name is James Bornow. I'm VP of Media and Partnerships here at Jellyfish, but that's not so important. What is really important is I have our wonderful panelists here, a guest from Google, Neil Hoyn, a wonderful human being. I've had the pleasure of introducing him and presenting alongside him a few times. Neil's the chief measurement strategist, but is a general privacy nut, maybe accidentally or by design, and is also passionate about measurement and attribution and everything that we do that proves out marketing. We have our very own Dee Wu, VP of Data Science. So super important because, of course, all of the smart stuff, the analysis, the segmentation, the measurement that we do that proves the worth of our craft is stuff that Dee and her team engineer to prove out and ultimately the end users of the data that we collect and use. So it's great to have Dee's perspective. And last but not least, of course, we have Adrienne, who is our data protection officer at Jellyfish. And what I kind of love about this lineup is we've got this full spectrum. We've got the compliance angle, we've got how you use and create data, and then we've got Google's perspective as well, because Neil's just such a well-rounded person when it comes to this. So with those introductions aside, thank you, panelists, for joining us very much. Let's just get straight into this, because I know we're going to have an exciting and a great conversation. One final thing, actually, you know, we will take Q&A. I'm probably going to do it at the end, unless I see just a red hot awesome question, and maybe we can interject that into the panelists. But feel free to use the Q&A box, and we'll be checking that periodically throughout the session. So with that done, I would like to kind of kick off. So let's take a sort of a broader look at the situation at hand and what we're dealing with here. So let's just think about the changes that we've got to deal with regulations, also with changes to our technology and our marketplace. So having to navigate cookies, for example, and not being able to have that mechanism. Will privacy change, and how are these changes ultimately going to go on and affect our marketing? So the broader topic. As we're starting out, as we've got a guest, Neil, I will just invite you to start the conversation, please.
You're going to give me the hard question, James.
Yeah, absolutely.
What's going to change? Everything. No, it's not that dramatic. Let's start from a very high level. This is just how I like to look at it. We have three areas of change going on. We have user preference. So how users want to be tracked, how they want their data to be captured by the companies they interact with. And this is expressed not only just with what they share, but also what they choose not to share. So implementing tools like Adblocker, which some organizations like eMarketer forecast as high as 25, 28% in some markets. So we have the user change. We have the technology change. So James, you touched on it, third-party cookies falling into it, but also just some of the things that we see coming out of companies like Apple, where during their Worldwide Developer Conference, they said, hey, you know what? Starting with our next version of iOS and macOS, we're going to start cutting down on being able to track things like email opens and email clicks. Or they're going to start introducing a product, this iCloud privacy relay, which may make it more difficult to capture IP addresses or location information for companies that try to use that for very precise targeting or even for things like fingerprinting. And then you have a third category, which is regulation, GDPR, CCPA, the alphabet soup of all of these things. And all of these come together really just to say from a marketing side, there's a lot happening. And we're reaching this point where we almost are looking and saying, is there going to be less data tomorrow than there is today? Yes. And that has a reason for concern for a lot of marketers to say, well, what is the path forward? How do I navigate this? Probably a lot of the stuff that we're going to be talking about here. But I think the larger takeaway is not simply that this is impactful, but that it's also an opportunity for growth. So informally, if I were to benchmark just the companies that we work with, about 90% of the marketers that we talk to are deferring these choices to legal or not acting on them at all. They're just kind of the wait and see approach. We'll see whatever gets taken away from me, whatever we have to do, we'll do with it at that time. The other 10% of companies are saying this is a moment for growth. It's to say, if we're all in the same auction, we're all competing for the same customers. If we're able to figure out a better strategy, then we could actually grow our business. Now, this disruption is going to impact everyone equally, which is why we want to focus and say, well, what are the real strategies? Instead of just looking at it and saying, we're losing our data, to say, how do we plot a course forward that will allow us to come out stronger and to have a better understanding, more trust with our customers, and be a better business because of it?
Yeah, right. And the nail that you're really, really, really great to open it up with the like the privacy, and also like just to follow up, there's like a ton of impact that all these privacy changes can have on our customers, our businesses, from just like a personal perspective, right? We all had the kind of like the creepy experience where we maybe read a blog somewhere and the next thing that you know, an ad promotion showed up on an Instagram feed, right? So that's like kind of like a traditional, you know, some of the third party kind of cookie and third party data kind of the tracking and lead a lot of that to kind of paranoia and some mistrust from the consumers. And just like from end user perspective, you know, from my perspective, I would feel like more comfortable if I know like where, how do they use my data? How do they share the information? And as a value exchange that I can get better experience, better, relevant product recommendation. I think that's a win-win for both the customer and the brand.
Yeah, I think you're right. Obviously as a PO, if you're asking me what's privacy changing, it's everything. First, pretty much gave me a career, so I'm not going to complain. But obviously it's going to impact every aspect of the company, right? Every company is impacted by, GDPR, for instance, has been in 2018, still is. And it's really complicated because everything you're doing has to change somehow. It's kind of still the same, but it's just a different way to put things. And as Dee has mentioned, I think if we're thinking in terms of, advertising, it's not that complicated a purpose. It's not really insidious. It's not a bad purpose. As a consumer, it makes sense to have, interest and hobbies and to have advertising content that is, really relevant to what you like and what you love. It makes sense. It's a service almost. And on the other hand, it's really what, the free internet is based upon, which, is a given today. But the problem is there hasn't been enough transparency. There has never been. And we feel like the digital marketing industry as consumers has been built upon data that they have kind of taken from us without our knowledge. And there's an expression that's used by privacy professionals, which is data vampires, for instance, which is supposed to be, Google, Apple, and all the professionals of targeted advertising, because they are just sucking your data, And it's just a matter of perspective. And this privacy development is really an opportunity for brands to renew with, this trust relationship with customers. And as you've mentioned, Neil, it's now or never. You have to do this. It's not a good option to just wait out the storm and think, okay, when cookies are gone, when my current strategy doesn't work anymore, then I'm going to think about a solution. It's going to be too late. And your customers might have moved on to your competitors who actually haven't been ironic and who've actually thought about privacy as a way to renew this trust with their customers.
It's interesting you bring that up, because that's something that's worth mentioning. A lot of people, when you bring up things like GDPR, I've worked with some companies like, well, we don't really have a big European presence, or with CCPA, they say, well, that's easy. We'll filter by IP address or mailing address for anyone in California. It's worth mentioning, and this is something just to consider, that the scope of a lot of these laws extends beyond what I think most companies believe. So the California Consumer Privacy Act, CCPA, we work with some companies on the East Coast, and they say, well, fine, if someone's mailing address or someone's IP address is in California, we give them these rights. That CCPA just allows them to request information, ask that it be deleted, et cetera. But the law is actually scoped a lot wider than what most companies think. So when they look at it, it's actually based on where somebody is a resident. So I'm sitting here in California. I'm a California resident. If I go to New York and I have a product shipped to my home in Chicago, still technically as a California resident, those rights may apply to me. And so now the company gets into a situation, they say, wait a minute, Neil could be in New York ordering to Chicago. How are we supposed to know he pays his income taxes in California? And that's exactly how the law is defined. You can't query to figure out which laws fall under which people. And so what companies are actually doing is they're looking at a lot of this legislation saying, what we see emerging is not, this is what we do for people in California versus this is what we do for people in Europe versus this is what we do for people in New York. They're looking at the strictest interpretation of these laws and saying, these are things we have to give everybody because we just can't tell. And because the risks of compliance or not compliance are so high, we have to treat almost everyone in the US as if they can request this information, or they can ask this information be deleted, or they don't track.
I agree. I think if you kind of like, if you take the easy way out, which is like a minimum implementation for the local requirement, you'll end up actually having more variety of different customized solutions to build. Because if you look at the GDPR and a lot of like the other European countries, right, you're required to be able to showcase your custom consent management, be able to actually track those consumers on your website. And now start to see like US and New York, and they start to talking about those legislation. So maybe it's good to continue to look at the, you know, what are the regions to model against and start to think about more standard and globalized approach.
Definitely. Makes a lot of sense. And Adrian, please, if you want to speak, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say that I agree, obviously, with both of you. And that's something that we say a lot at Jellyfish, is that privacy is both global and local. Because obviously, it's global, it's going to impact every aspect of the company, both it's global in terms of entities, in terms of organizations. It's also global because, well, you have these laws emerging throughout the globe. I mean, just last week, we had Colorado signing their Privacy Act. It's going to keep on happening. There are going to be more and more privacy laws and regulations throughout the globe in the coming month and years. So, Dee, you're right as well. If you're thinking, okay, I'm going to do the bare minimum, and then, oh no, this entity, which is, I don't know, in Japan in October, has to comply with new rules. Okay, so I'm going to apply a very specific set of rules in Japan, but what happens if I'm a global company? I want to have this kind of holistic vision of my data. I do not know where this data comes from, or worse, I know that it comes from Japan, and I know that now that it's seen in France, it has to be GDPR compliant as well, but I haven't exactly used the same rules in Japan, so it's a never-ending story. And it's local, obviously, because of that. And so you need to make sure that you understand this. And the single best way to do this is to have this approach of thinking, what is the worst case scenario? What is the toughest, strictest rule that I have to apply? And just applying throughout the globe. It has to be reasonable for your business to still work. And so the question is not, do I just kind of cherry pick the rules that I want to comply with? It's more so, how do I find a way to make it work within my business? And so that's why you have jobs such as DPO and why we have, well, this conversation today.
And Adrian, I think like it's not just like one rule fits all, right? Because when we're talking about standardization, just kind of like clarify myself a little bit, it's not about one kind of like, legal documents fits for everything. It's incredibly nuanced in different region and local, but we're talking about more like a standard kind of like strategy and the framework to be able to think about it. And if we think about it, there's so many area and so many nuanced considerations. It's from tech implementation perspective, that we have to consider, you know, how do we track data in a more sensible way and how can we utilize those data? And also from legal perspective, how do we configure the legal documents on your different various different websites? And all of these different pieces have to work together in a coherent way.
Great. So awesome. So I think like there's definitely an impetus. Like we need a plan. There is quite a lot to take into account when you're designing your solutions and you're making sure your company is prepped. But like we talk a lot when we talk about consent, we're always talking about collection, permissions, you know, quite rightly. But like the downstream effect on our marketing activities, like not getting this right, like what's the impact, Dee? Because you use data to prove marketing works. You use data to segment like users. What do you see the risks are of not acting properly?
Yeah, and obviously, like as a data scientist, I'm a bit more biased in terms of the usage of data. And you know, the whole premise of the machine learning and data science is built on, you know, collecting the volume of data to kind of like using the data as a paradigm instead of the hard-coded configured manual rules to be able to predict the consumer behavior, et cetera, right? So the data volume is important, but for me, I think the quality is even more important today, because if we don't care about data quality, that the you know garbage in, garbage out scenario, right? So we're all familiar with that. So that just from like a data science perspective, and I think it's even more nuanced from the marketing perspective. Because of the limitation of the conversion tracking today, it is even harder to be able to have that holistic view of the user journey. And you know, some of the you know new solutions such as consent mode, it's incredibly important in terms of you know filling the gap, because tracking the conversions would have like downstream impact to measure your media. And you know, there is a best practice such as consent mode or site-wide tagging or like enhanced conversion. Those are the area that the company should be thinking about as a way to, you know, improve their further like conversion model and media measurement. But I can understand, you know, the understanding and be able to explaining all these different area and impact to the marketing to DPO could be a challenging process, and it could be very kind of take a long time to actually get it approved.
And Neil, you've been involved in the measurement conversation from, I don't know, the year dot, let's say. And this is just another chapter to a degree. Would you say that's kind of right? And how do you frame that in the wider context of measurement?
We touched on it earlier where it's a question of trust with your consumers. Do they trust you with their data? And can you make that case compelling? Because really what we're talking about in this privacy era, if you really distill it down to, is being very clear about a consumer's choice to say, I want to share or not share. Let's look at iOS 14.5 as an example. Before, it was you download an app and that app just in the background could track everything that you were doing for the purposes of advertising. And Apple said, as part of this drive, this transition to consent, we're going to ask customers if they want to trust you with their data. And I'll give you this, the opt-in message, if you've seen it, is absolutely miserable. It's like, do you want this company to be able to track you for the purposes of advertising? And we're not surprised. We see only 4% of people that opt in. And then unfortunately, Dee and her team are saying, well, great, there goes 96% of our data. And you start to have questions. Who are the 4% of people that are opting in? Are they people that don't understand the prompt, that are feeling very generous with their data? So the companies at first, and this is kind of the basic level, everyone starts and they throw their hands up and they say, ah, we lost the data. And then what we see is we see more sophisticated companies and saying, no, we have to demonstrate the value to our consumers. And so you see just a small handful of companies. I love this. Twitter does this exceptionally well, where before you receive that prompt, they actually have a message and they try to explain to you what the value proposition is by sharing that data. And it's very simple. It's not perfect. I'd say it's elegant though, where I will bet you that they see greater opt-in rates than their competitors that don't use that message. And about 90% of apps do not. And so what we're learning as marketers is we're learning to go through that process and asking that question. So as where before it was all around data capture, what can we measure with what tags and what tools and what systems? Now companies are taking a step back and being a little bit more deliberate. They're saying, even though we have all these systems in place, what do we have to do to build that trust with the audience? How do we have that conversation? So what's going to happen? If there's going to be more alphabet soup style legislation coming out that's going to restrict privacy, again, all based on consent, we see as a best practice, a lot of companies are going out and they're working with their partners. They're working with companies like Jellyfish to say, how do we build that trust with our consumers? So instead of waiting for them to have that option to opt out, how do we go for them and say, this is the data we need. This is what we're going to do with it. And how do we make sure that that exchange is balanced so that you want to participate? And not everybody will, but if the average right now with iOS is 4%, if you're able to get 8% of people to opt in, you're doubling the available amount of data you have versus your competitors, versus the industry. And so companies are getting a jump on it and saying, look, if I need to ask people for their data, if I need to ask them for permission, what do I have to say? What do I have to do? How do I invest in that trust? What do I incentivize them for? And these were questions just a lot of marketers are saying, well, face value, opt in, yes or no. And now they're saying, no, we really want to get this right. We want to build that trust. So that's almost a challenge I'd say to the entire audience is to start thinking about these rules and to start thinking about the larger landscape and say, how are you going to build that trust with your audience? What does that flow look like? Because the ROI there is incredible right now.
Yeah, that's awesome. So almost like you could say it's potentially an evolution of what that, you know, we used to talk about the value exchange being between advertisers and publishers and end users, and maybe this is an extra chapter to that as well. But do you feel, so it's definitely important for sure, the stuff to get our heads around, but it's happening now. Do you feel companies are actually moving fast enough? And Adrian, you know, like, not to typecast legal and compliance, but there's diligence and stuff that people get their head around. Are you seeing companies move fast enough to make this happen, do you think?
Oh, it's hard to say, but I think, you know, companies never move fast enough because first thing is you do not really know what you're dealing with, right? When you're seeing a piece of legislation such as the GDPR, right? There's just so much in there and so little at the same time. That's like, you have, for instance, this obligation of security, which seems like really the center of data protection, right? The word protection tells it, oh, it has to be secured. And it also goes with, you know, really respecting the data that your customers have entrusted you with. You have to protect it, you have to secure it. But regarding security, you have two articles, like half a page in the entire GDPR. So it's nothing. You don't really know what you're supposed to be doing. And so a lot of companies are really waiting either to see someone get caught doing something wrong and just not even, you know, thinking in terms of being evil or I don't know, just thinking, okay, this was not what we were supposed to be doing. Okay, let's cross this off and move on to another possibility. So in that sense, most companies are not moving fast enough. There's also the fact that simply you've been doing the same thing for dozens of years, maybe, and it's been working. And you've been creating this all this innovation with this wealth of data that you have. And all of a sudden, there's this change of paradigm and you've moved from getting as much data as you could to try and determine exactly how you could use it to having to know first what the purpose is, then what the means are and what is the data that you need, that you have the rights even to be collecting and processing. And that also feels like a lot to take in. But if you're thinking the other way around, and as Neil has mentioned, if it's about trust, if you have to make sure that you have this fair value exchange with your consumers, then they need to have this level of transparency. And how can you bring that level of transparency if you do not know exactly what data you're going to be collecting, what for, how long you're going to be to keep the data, everything. So this information needs to be known in advance just to make sure that your user feels like they can trust you. Right. So there's a lot to do. And that means that you have to think about everything And that takes both a lot of time, a lot of energy. And sometimes companies feel like it's just not worth it at the moment.
Absolutely. And Adrian. Task. But like, so Neil, we know that if you don't act, you see opportunity in this. So obviously, yeah, people have to move fast enough. But Dee, as the user, does this concern you that the data that you operate on may be changing soon? Like, sure, you'd like to get ahead of that. Like, how do you feel about the speed to action?
I think similar to what Adrian was talking about earlier, right? The change of the paradigm require a mindset kind of shift as well. But, talking about, third-party cookie going away and the first-party data is more and more important. And we have been kind of talking to this to our clients for years, and it's not a new concept. But, if we ask our client, 90% of our client would say, first-party data is extremely important. But probably only 1/3 of them are using the first-party data effectively, and we can really see a value out of it. And, why first-party data is more important? And I think today is just like a good time to start to think about how can I make a difference? How can I use my first-party to creating differentiated value and creating that opportunities compared to my competitors? And why it's so important, right? The first-party data compared to third-party cookie, like a third-party data, where the data could be more like a sporadic, right? The first-party data is more consistent. It has a better quality. It is more relevant to your business and more relevant message to your customers. And also, it is very differentiating. You can customize your tracking. You can create different collection, different variables that matters to your customer. So, with that, just like some examples that we did with one of the food companies, that they have, different blogs and articles about their product, and to be able to leverage that information and be able to, using the web behavior and also different keywords on site and looking at different content from the articles and be able to build different customer persona, that would create a lot of value for your customers so that they can get more relevant messaging and a more personalized web experience. And also you can create your marketing strategy purely based on, the first party data that you created to drive more efficient marketing there. So I think that's a really good example. And I think that's kind of a, just like a teaser to start to think about it. We already sitting on big volumes of data at the moment, and how can we let the data do the work for us?
Wise words, exactly. So just shifting gears a little bit. So we've talked about like what this kind of means for the market, like what it means for consent, et cetera. But let's turn and kind of look internally inside companies. Like, I think it's amusing because we've got data science and a DPO on the call, like two traditionally would be different departments inside a client's organization. So how do you guys feel that companies can set themselves up for success by working together to get the best out of this situation? And Neil, I know you have the enviable position or not of talking to lots and lots of companies all the time. Like, how are you seeing people tackle this as a team? Is there any goodness that you're seeing there or paradoxically anything that's not so good?
James, I think companies are learning. I think that with companies where legal's leading the initiative, sometimes without the input of marketing, they are following the strict letter of the law. Adrian, I'm putting you in this category here. Oh. And it says, look, this is what the regulation requires. This is what we will do, which is great. And that's a reasonable way to go through it. But then you have marketers on the other side that are like, so legal just said we can no longer do this, 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 and this. We have to pull this data out. So take something like compliance with the California Consumer Privacy Act, CCPA. Somebody requests their data. We've seen companies where legal sets up reasonable processes to go across the organization and grab that data. And that's reasonable. But then we see marketers say, if only legal knew what we could get by automating and integrating our customer data. Imagine the marketing opportunities that would open up if we now had all this information in one place, and at the same time, we could reduce compliance costs. Here's one of my worst stories. As James mentioned, I'm kind of a privacy nut on this kind of stuff. So when CCPA went into effect as a California resident, I filed requests with over 150 companies for my CCPA data. And I was surprised at the processes that resulted. One so far is to one major travel company had to go to every property that I visited over the past 5 years and request from that property my data. They sent me a 180-page PDF at the end. That was a lot of work, and they had to do that for every consumer. And when I spoke to the marketing team at that organization, they're like, we've been trying to make the case as to how easy this would be if we could just integrate all this data together. But we haven't been able to get legal's attention. Legal's just doing it from a compliance side. So you see that part. Where legal runs, you just get strict compliance. Where marketing runs, you often miss steps. And so when both teams come together, it's great because legal can provide the lens to say, this is what we have to do within the context of the law. Marketing can say, this is how we can then take that information and repurpose it somewhere else. And so when those two groups get together, admittedly, while they speak a different language, I think that's where you really see the greatest opportunity because they can both see the full picture together.
Yeah, the context for each other becomes really important, like to operate and do things well. Adrian, what do you think about that? Like, you know, because you're our DPO, but you speak to many brands. Like, how's this playing out?
Nothing to add to that, really. Because, no, to be honest, it happens really often that we, you know, we're working with a client or prospective clients, and we have these amazing use cases using their first party data most of the time at the moment, because they are thinking of third party depreciation and they want to know what they can do with their data and everything. And so they have these awesome use cases. And at the time when we have to start, you know, the contracting process or even end the contracting process, so we're that far into the process. And then there's the DPO or the privacy team or the legal team. And all of a sudden say, oh, wait, there's data there. We need to know exactly what's going on. And then we will have this back and forth in this call with the data protection officer, chief privacy officer, or anyone from the privacy team. And it's going to take a while because they have no idea what marketing is talking about. And it's really a problem of vocabulary. And that is hard for everyone because from a DPO point of view and working with our legal team, I can tell you that no one takes pride or pleasure at, you know, making you wait 3 weeks longer than you should have to make that contract sign and the mission start. Obviously not. And so that's definitely a key thing. And one of the things that we try to do when working not only on privacy, but we're working with clients, is make sure that they have all the cards that they need to be able to work with their legal teams whenever there is, you know, data involved. And we're talking about digital marketing, right? The data is at the center of everything. So we are in this new privacy era, and data protection officers, privacy teams have to be involved and have to ensure that there is a coherent vision with privacy throughout the group, throughout the organization. So that means that these persons should know exactly what you are talking about when it comes to digital marketing.
Yeah, that makes so much sense. And like, you know, we talk about, Jennifer, we talk about privacy by design. We want people to take stock, look at their organization holistically and think about it through a privacy lens and design those solutions and ways of working, etc. Just quickly on this point, like Dee, like, how often do you get or people in your team get invited to the conversation about data collection and permissions? Is that something that happens? I'm assuming you'd say it should happen more if it doesn't. How do you feel about that?
I would say we are at the luck of very probable hands of Adrian because you know, it's the coolest thing is that you know, our DPO fortunately understand like the nuances of the marketing, of the privacy, and everything that is you know, going on, so that we can really build this trust and this kind of like the partnership with our legal team, so that we can like confidently like say, if I wanted to do this analysis with this data, I would make Adrian my best friend and be able to consult with him. Like, you know, what, like, is it good? Is it like good use of data? Is there like any consequences or anything? You know, I think just like this partnership is really working. And I think really not much to add on there what Neil and Adrian already mentioned, but I would say like, you know, the education, like on both sides, and I think that's such a key factors to be able to have this open dialogue within different departments, because it's unavoidable at this point. It's a must.
That's such a good point. It is unavoidable. Like, it's something that you have to act on. Fantastic. So I think, you know, working with wonderful people, great panelists such as yourselves, like, you make my job very easy. And we've kind of touched on some of the points here that I wanted to bring up. But like, the opportunity that this brings, and Neil, you were great at highlighting potentially as the first mover advantage. You're playing against other people in your peer group in the market. Like, what other opportunities, guys, do you think that this fosters and brings to the table? And Neil, I'll give that to you.
I mean, I look at it just from saying that when we look at all the data, I think the general positioning of companies has been collect as much data as possible and then figure out what you're going to do with it later on. And I think that destroyed a lot of trust. I think it led to bad practices where you'd go to websites and you'd throw up remarketing ads as soon as somebody left, or you'd connect data sources that individual consumers weren't expecting. And this is just kind of a moment, I think, for the entire industry to take a step back and to really say a few things. One, how do we build that trust with our users so they understand and want to share that data? And in D's world, this could be fantastic, because I would hope, and then we've seen some data to this, that it's leading to higher quality data sharing. I understand the value, so I'm going to provide more information. I'm going to help, like, even I can correct the record so you know who I am. And I also think it leads to companies to more focus, is that as long as there's been that paradigm where data is a new oil, companies have just been collecting volume. And now when we start talking about application, they have to focus into say, well, what are we really doing with this data? Where are we applying it? And I think that may actually lead to better quality data sets and more application. It just won't be around collection. It will be around, you know, more of the consumer-oriented activities. And that feels like a net plus, both from a marketing side, but also as a consumer. I'd love to know all the companies that have my information, know the relationship with them. I'd share more with some companies if I knew it. And that's not a bad thing. So I think there's opportunities both on the companies to become more focused and to build better relationships with the people they work with.
Dee, how's that sound to you?
I think that's fantastic, right? I think like previously we definitely see company that are just like collecting data, like any data that they can get their hands on. And that's lead to a lot of, you know, downstream problem, right? And it's not cheap either. It's a big price tag in terms of collecting the data, store and you know, processing the data and just maintain that data integrity. And at the end of the day, the data science team has to go into it and figure out, you know, what kind of use cases can we build. But instead, I think this is a good opportunity that we can actually think about this from the beginning, right? To start to think about, you know, what data are we collecting, and you know, is there any good use cases? I would say highly recommend include the data scientists even into the early conversation when you're thinking about collecting the data, because they can think about, you know, what are the metrics, what are the key variables that you can create, and what are the kind of problem, what are the use case you can actually have. And that would actually save a lot of time later on to actually retrofit into the, you know, justification of the budget allocation of creating this data lake, right? Yeah, so like just one example that we had is that if you're just talking about Google Analytics data, we're doing a lot of tracking and implementation for our clients, and with all the GA4 and with all the different, you know, different platform, and it's quite important to standardize. You would run into a lot of naming conventions. If you don't think about this from the beginning, you would end up with duplicated tracking. You would tracking variables that would never be used. But instead, think about, you know, what are the default variables and what are the additional variables that you can use, and making sure everything that you track actually lead to a valuable use case in the future. And I think that's a that's maybe the first step to think about. And you know, doesn't mean that if you haven't done this at the beginning, you'll be at loss. As I would, like in my perspective, I think the privacy and all of this data strategy and consideration, it's always our mission. It shouldn't start with, it's not the once for all. It should be periodically reviewed and continue to think about, you know, what data are not useful and how can we, you know, get new data sources and how can we clean our data and how can we come up with new use case. And I think that's a constant, like, periodically kind of audit refresher, rinse and refresh kind of process.
Makes so much sense. Guys, thank you so much. So we're going to move on to Q&A. We've got a couple of questions very quick in just a second. But really quickly, if there's anything that you haven't sort of touched on throughout this conversation that you want to highlight here, you know, what do you see that's emerging as good? Adrian, why don't you start us off if there's anything you want to share there?
As good. I think the key thing is what we've already touched upon a few times, which is make sure that there's some coordination, that there is communication between your compliance team and your marketing team. And make sure that, you know, people understand within your organization that it's not the end of the world. We've talked about trust at least a dozen times during the session. But I think that if you see this from the other perspective, and as a data science expert, I think you will be able to appreciate this. All the data that you have that is, you know, not really from people who like your product, that is just, you know, that is ad blocked, or that is you have this double tracking of things. All of this is noise, right? It's noise. You're losing the quality of your signal, of your information. And if we go back to 2018, when GDPR came into force, people felt that this was going to be the end of email marketing, for instance. Everybody received dozens, hundreds of emails of websites you didn't even know you had accounts on, which told you, okay, we have updated our privacy policy. We are GDPR compliant, blah, 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 because of GDPR. We are giving you the option to opt out. So first, opt out is not necessarily the right way to do this, but that's not the issue here. But it also meant that you might have 90% of your database that just went away. And at the time, that was the key, the real one true KPI, right? Or one of the more major KPIs. How many people are you able to reach? What's your audience? How many people are in your database? And you lost a lot of people there. But what that meant as well was that the people who were left were those who really wanted to know about your products. This is your key audience. And all of a sudden, all the noise is gone, and you're able to conduct really thorough and, well, really useful analysis to make you able to make the right decisions, basically. And that's kind of what is going on with third-party cookies going away as well in digital marketing as a whole.
Perfect. Yeah, again, makes sense. Neil, anything to add to what you've already said about what is emerging as good in your eyes?
I would just say set the objective not to replace the data that's being lost, but simply to move a little bit faster than your competition. How do you know? Go with your gut feeling as you're seeing some of these things. I don't want to read up on these laws. I have 18 months. Until these laws go into effect. I'll let legal handle it. Those types of gut reactions are what most companies are doing. Your challenge is to fight beyond that. If it's just legal working on it, you want to say, how can marketing be part of the conversation? If it's, you see this data going away, how can we find proxies? How can we get ahead of it? If we have to wait 2 years until we ask people if they want to share their data, can you start learning from it now? Even those small steps are going to put you ahead of the market in terms of building that trust that we spoke about. And then also just getting ahead of your competition. That's what it is. Don't get infatuated by saying, how can we replace every single thing that we're losing and how can we work around and model it? Those exercises will take years to solve. Just look to say, how can you become a little bit better in handling this privacy and this trust issue than you are today?
Perfect. And finally, Dee, anything to add on that before we move into Q&A?
Yeah, I guess kind of just like a touch on what we already said earlier. I mean, we all kind of like born into this digital age and had the conception of you know, measure everything and creating this perfect, you know, digital journey and the measurement plan, it has been challenged, but it's never been a reality. It's going to be even more challenging today. And I would say just like, it's a good time that it buy a little bit time with the new announcement, but I think it's good to take a look at the things from, you know, different angle and start to diversify your strategy a little bit more instead of focus on more, you know, audience focused and hyper kind of accurate, precise marketing, and start to think about, you know, are there any other interesting data points such as, you know, geo and the contextual, you know, and looking at things in a different lens and, you know, creating, you know, these are the different angle that could create some differentiator factors compared to your competitors there.
Oh, fantastic. Well, awesome. Everybody, thank you so much for sharing your minds, your personalities, and your thoughts with us. I think that's been great and insightful. I've been scanning the chat box while we're here. We've got a couple of questions. And Aaron or Aaron, depending on where you are in the world, does ask us to kind of talk a little bit about Google Consent Mode. And can we put in layman's terms kind of how that works and kind of what it does? Anybody want to weigh in on that?
Go ahead, Dee.
Yeah, I would say like just like the simplest form, it's the data pre-collection, right? So before you're even collecting the user's data, and it's a technology where you can implement to your website that would send you a PIN before the user have the consent. So with that data, that you can manage that data in your consent management. So that, you know, additional percentage that could be creating more accurate signals for the conversion modeling.
Yeah, Neil, was there anything you wanted to add?
The way that I generally distill it down is consent mode is, do you have the consent of the user to fire a tag to send data someplace else? So instead of just any user that comes to the website, you just start firing off 10 or 20 different tags and sending that data to other third parties. Consent mode allows you to add a layer to say, hey, do they consent on us sharing this data? And based on that answer, sending data in a different way to different places. So more of a compliance thing, but it's a great thing to be able to honor the user's consent instead of forcing them to use an ad blocker to do that instead.
Cool, makes perfect sense. So it's a bit like an externally facing tag management solution. So like in a way, right? Awesome. And then Christopher Hoffman asks, what is the fate of using first-party data for creation of lookalike audiences in this new environment? How does that manifest? And I think, Dee, I see you nodding. Take it away.
I think it's a difficult question, right? We're trying to anticipate the changes in the landscape, we all have our different, you know, beliefs in terms of the future of the, you know, the first party cookie and how does that implicate into the future solutions. But I do think there's a strong advantage with first party data that you collect, let alone about all the similar audiences. If the similar audience is still based on the third party cookie, obviously that would have impact to it. But the other advantage is that you can use your first party data to plug into the walled garden scenario that you can work with, you know, Google, Facebook, and different platform. And I think that's really, really powerful use case there as well.
Okay, fantastic. All right, I'm jumping into the question Q&A box. We've got quite a lot in here, actually, so that's fantastic. So thank you for participating. I love an interactive audience. So first question here, this is pretty meaty. Lucas asks, Facebook recently said that their standard contractual clauses, or SCCs, won't be sufficient to legally transfer personal data from the EU to the US, resulting in a huge problem for online advertisers. With respect to all other US companies offering ad solutions, like Google, Amazon, Pinterest, etc., how would this affect European advertisers? And is there a solution that Jellyfish recommends for clients? So, big one there. Sounds a little bit compliancy, Adrian, or anybody. Do we have an answer or a point of view on that?
I mean, yes, we do, obviously. But the first thing is that obviously we are not a law firm, so we are not allowed to provide legal advice to our clients. So we wouldn't be providing our clients with recommendations in terms of how to frame their transfers to third party to third countries. But that said, SCCs can still be applied in a way, but it's just the responsibility is on the controller to make sure that there are sufficient safeguards, right? And in that respect, for instance, Google has provided a number of documents which lists out the additional safeguards that they have implemented to try and make those SCCs applicable, or model contractual clauses, as they're called within the Google Ads data processing terms. But really, it's for the controller, so our clients, to determine whether sending data to the US is still feasible under SCCs with those additional safeguards. And of course, we're here with our clients to help them navigate what that means and to try and determine where to find that information and get the information from our partners, if at all possible. But that is really the extent of what we are allowed to do if we want to avoid really treading in that dangerous territory of legal advice.
Right. No, that makes that. Yeah, that's perfect. And well answered. That's a kind of complex situation. Moving on there, I have a question from Julie who asks, if the deprecation of third-party cookies isn't a regulatory requirement, which of course it isn't, why should we include the privacy and legal team when trying to address this? So I think there's two things that need to be considered. Neil, do you want to have a...
I'll give a quick answer to it. I think that when information and data goes away, especially as we try to build first-party data to replace what's lost with third-party cookies, there's going to be that legal component to say, what can we collect and how can we collect it? And working in that part, working together, as opposed to a case where legal comes back later and says, you just collected all this data to replace first-party cookies, but we don't think it can be transferred or shared or used. Get it right the first time. The way that you look at it is legal is your partner to help you understand how to future-proof your business and the data you're capturing. With third-party cookies going away, you want to have that strategy and that conversation about what you can replace it with.
Yeah, absolutely. That makes so much sense again. So going down the question list really quickly, Lucas, I'm going to skip you. You raised a really interesting point about opportunities that GDPR created, but we'll come back to that one. Michelle Hogarth asks, as far as I know, conversion modeling isn't available in South Africa yet. Would you recommend waiting on deploying consent mode until it's available? Because right now, if users opt out, we'd have no way to model for that lost data. I'll throw that to anybody that wants to put their hat in the ring.
I'll give it a try. My general guidance is you comply with user expectations and local laws. So if they're looking for this type of consent to be placed on top of any types of tags, then we accept that for what it is. The other side that I look at it all, also, if it's not required by law, it's still something that I would experiment with to look at the impact to your data and how those processes change. Very similar to what we talk about incentives and opt-ins. Always get ahead of it to see what that user response is and see how you can optimize for it. So you're almost testing that pipeline before it becomes applicable to local law. So I generally don't like to lose data, but I like to know what I'm getting into, even if it's not immediately required.
Great, perfect. Anybody else got something to add to that? We've got great questions in the box here, so I can move on. Yep, fantastic. So from David, I would like to hear your point of view in regards of transparency, starting with using plain, simple, and concise language to allow users to understand the terms and conditions that they're requested to accept. Do you believe that companies should let their users know with which companies they are partnering and sharing data? So I guess it's about explaining that value exchange and taking users on this journey and educating. Neil, this is something that you talk about quite a lot.
This looks like an age-old question. I'll give you my quick answer. I look at this from the consumer perspective. Would I want to know as an individual consumer who has my data? Yeah. Damn right, I want to know who has it. So of course, I would expect companies to share it with me. That's the position that I take. I think that it is great for companies to let other consumers know where that data is going, how they're using it. And to be honest, and Adrian, I'll let you comment on it because this is deeper in your area than mine. We see this as an emerging requirement. So in California, an upcoming piece of privacy, California Privacy Rights Act stipulates that you have to specify what you are doing with the data and how you're applying things like machine learning, giving consumers the ability to opt out of that. So the more transparency, the better. That's generally my take.
No, definitely. And although it might not be easy to really, you know, use plain, simple language, because it's both, well, in our case, it's both legal. So you have your legal counsel who like love this, you know, 10 lines, paragraphs, these sentences with no end and so many commas, you're just wondering where they're going to stop. And on the other hand, we're working with digital marketing, right? Try explaining programmatic advertising to, you know, a five-year-old, for instance. That's going to be a nightmare. But on the other hand, it's really key to, you know, to gain trust of your users, your data subjects. And it's a good exercise as well. We are talking about privacy. It's for everyone. And we are talking about transparency. So it has to be transparent. It has to be simple. And it's a very difficult exercise, but it's a necessary one, definitely.
Okay, that's fantastic. Thanks. Right, with 1 minute to go, one more question. From an e-commerce point of view, we use user and session data alongside transactional data, of course, from our sales platform to calculate conversion rates, etc. With a loss of user data, how would you suggest calculating accurate conversion rates? Dee, seems to be your speed, really.
Yeah, I think you know, it's a bit harder to answer it because you know, without like more context into your questions. So one thing is that you know, what we're talking about today is more about, you know, the third party data, and the first party data in terms of transaction data, that should be a one of the first party data that you should own. But I understand from e-commerce, it could be a different scenario where you have your sales data with a different vendor, such as like maybe a different like a wholesale partner that you're partnering with. And I think that that could be a bit more complicated answer there, but there's a bunch of different solutions that you can consider, maybe partner with LiveRamp, and partner with some other kind of data onboarders to be able to build that connections between different data resides in different systems.
Fantastic. Okay, we had a couple of questions that aren't answered. We would love to follow up with those people, like maybe directly, and maybe there's a way that we can do that, and that would be fantastic. We were very lucky to assemble some great panelists, very busy people, so we have to finish on time, sadly. I could sit here and listen to these people all day, but I just want to, you know, obviously thank you so much for your time. A huge thanks to the audience for being so wonderful and providing our questions. I hope this was valuable for you guys as well. With that said, all we can say is, you know, this is a global thing and a local thing. You need to prepare. If you get ahead, you're only competing against people in the same boat. There's opportunity just by doing the right things. Consumers are going to be more savvy as generations proceed, and as these topics get more traction in the mainstream media and news, we need to be doing the right thing by consumers. There's going to be a new value exchange emerging between marketers, brands, and the end users. I think that's some of our key takeaways. Be prepared. Get ahead of it, people. Privacy is a wonderful thing. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you to the panelists again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.